Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you all here. Hope you all had a very blessed Thanksgiving. Now we look in anticipation to the celebration of the birth of our Lord. If you're visiting with us today, we'd ask that you might fill out the flap on the front of the bulletin and place it in the seat as you leave, and so we have a record of your attendance. Please be mindful of those who have been shown on our prayer list, as well as others you may know. Also, we have anniversaries and birthdays this week. On the 30th is Lynn and Becky Bonenblust, and we have birthdays this coming week. On the 28th, James Kuntz, and on the 2nd, Melissa Stellner and Natalie Vesta. So as you're remembering those on our prayer list, you might remember those people too and give them a little recognition, a little pat on the back for going through another cycle around the sun. As special announcements, I'd like to thank last week was a busy week here at First Baptist Church. 1 o'clock, we decorated the church for Christmas. I'd like to thank everybody who was involved in that. They did a splendid job. Then, thanks to everyone who brought Operation Christmas Child boxes. They had 20 boxes here, plus there were numerous ones that were made online that we don't know about. So we thank you for participating in that. And then last Sunday evening, we went out to the Adams Farm, and we had a hayrack ride. And we'd like to thank them for their hospitality and a great time. We had a good time. There were 32 of us, and it was fun, and we need to do it again. Also, tonight at 6 o'clock p.m. is Carols and Candlelight, and that always kind of kicks off our Christmas season here. Then on Sunday the 12th will be the Christmas Cantata, and then also the 12th that evening will be the Gingerbread Bash. That will begin at 6 p.m. It's a fun family event for everybody. You're all welcome to come, and we can come and celebrate the true meaning of Christmas. And then on the 19th, which is Sunday at 6 o'clock, we'll go Christmas caroling. So keep those, put those on your calendar and be able to participate in that. Also, this Wednesday from noon to 1:30, the ladies are having a super Christmas lunch. And
not this week?
Oh, it's next week. Okay, next week. So I got ahead of myself. But you can be preparing your cookies, and you can bring them next week so we can try them out. So we have this gingerbread bash coming up. Well, our church had a float in the Christmas parade after Thanksgiving evening, the Friday after Thanksgiving evening, and it was a lot of fun. If any of you have ever been on one of those, it's an experience. The float moves a whole lot faster than what you could walk. The float was decorated in a gingerbread theme, and we had our gingerbread man Bill standing in the back of the pickup, and then there were four people dressed up as gingerbread people handing out these little packets, Patty and Pastor and Dylan and myself. And if you try to keep up with float handout packages, you got a job on your hand. So we're lagging behind the float a little bit, and we get to the end, and there's no float. We don't know where we're going. Well, we look down the alley, clear down to 6th Street, and there's our float getting ready to turn out on the highway and come down. So we start walking down towards the float, and Patty and Dylan and I, Pastor jumped ship with us evidently, because he was on the float, but there were three of us walking down this alley, so Dylan gets on his phone and he calls someone, I don't know who he called on the float, and said, wait, you know, we need a ride, and I heard them say, well, run. And I heard the most beautiful words I've ever heard just gracefully lisp out of the lips of Patty, and she said, gingerbread man, don't run. So it was fun. So if you get the opportunity to do that, you need to do that sometime in your list. You can put that on your bucket list. Are there any other announcements that need to be made? I see the Jensens have their light display up. It was good. I took the tour online. It was fun. It was interesting. I drive by. And the Seamers have theirs up, too. So if you're traveling around town, those are two high spots you need to see. Any other announcements that need to be made? If not, let's stand together and sing our song of worship, O Come, Emmanuel. And it's been for ages since we've had an amen at the end of the song, but this one does. Thank you. God and Father in heaven, we come and we rejoice here this morning. We rejoice in the fact that we are free. We live in a free country where we can come and that we can worship you. We can worship you in your house and have fear, no fear of retribution of any sort. We ask that you be with us, be in our midst this morning, that we might feel your presence as we come here to celebrate our love for you. We pray you'll be with our pastor, be with each and every one of our church leadership, that you might guide and direct them in our congregation as we make our way through these troubling times. We ask that you be with our pastor this morning as he delivers your message. Be with us, that we might receive from it as you wish for us to. We thank you for all the many blessings that you give to us and your guidance and your love and the salvation you've given to us. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Scripture this morning is out of the book of Matthew, chapter 1, verses 18 through 23. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. After his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man, and not wanting to make her a public example, was minded to put her away secretly. But while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. And she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. So all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, Behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated God with us. And please be seated. And now Robin will be reading a poem for us.
Grace and peace to all of you this morning, and I'm reading a poem on behalf of the first Sunday of Advent. This poem is called Emmanuel, and it is God with Us by Justin Irving. It seems quite strange that on the day the Lord of heaven and earth would lay amidst the straw-filled stable stall, though he was sovereign over all. For he was God, yet did not grasp his rightful place before the mass of many laud-filled cherubim and hosts of holy seraphim. He rather made himself to be a humble servant of his King and of his Father's holy will that offered him upon the hill to pay for our iniquities and take up our infirmities. The Lord of hosts did lay on him the weight of all our crushing sin. This is the reason that God gave to him the name above all names, that at the name of Jesus bow all heaven and earth, for this is how it ought to be. And now I see he is the one sure majesty who reigns forevermore. Adore this one true King who is our Lord. For unto us was born that day within the humble stall and hay our mighty God and Prince of Peace, the one who rules will never cease. And yet it seems now so profound that King of all would cry a sound of humbleness and need for rest to lay upon his mother's chest. We serve a mighty God and King whose humbleness did meet our need. Through coming as a lowly man, he met for us God's just demands. So worship God and all he is from infant's birth on up to his eternal reign and kingly might, and live forever in his light.
Thank you, Robin. Now let's join in praising God by singing our hymn, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. You'll find it on page 244 if you want to follow along in the hymnal, where the words are on the screen. Spice, who helped to decorate the church float. You know, you don't think that those floats, I know when, if you saw the church, the First Baptist Church float, I know you all would be massively, massively impressed at the workmanship that went into that, right? That's when you say amen. Amen! But the Three Stooges, Bill, Robin, and I spent hours putting that together, but we had fun. So I'd like to tell you that we didn't stop and talk at all, that we were diligently working every second, but you know that's not the case. But we thank everyone. It just reminds us that as a church, we're a family. It's not one person, it's all of us working together. And we handed out over 400 of those little packets, and there were still more. I was so blessed that at the end, when we ran out of the little packets, we had got some glow sticks for the people that were sitting on the float, and everyone started sacrificing their glow sticks, even the children. The children were like, here, take mine, so that we could give them to the kids that were there, so they could have something from us. And so that was a great blessing for me. All right, so let's go to the Lord in prayer. And before we do that, just so as you're not shocked, we did receive news yesterday that Pastor Bob Hanthorn passed away at the end of last week. And so do be praying for their family. Also, Dominic's father, Tony Carlosano, is doing much better. He's up. He's able to eat whatever he wants. So we praise the Lord for that. But now if you'll go with me to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we do humbly come before you this morning, and we're so very thankful for the many ways that you do work in our lives. We're thankful that you are present with us this morning, and that we have the opportunity to worship you as we choose to worship you. We ask that these requests that have been shared, that you would work in each of these situations according to your will. Father, we pray with the Hanthorn family that you would bless and encourage them as they mourn the loss of Pastor Bob. And we are thankful for his testimony of faith, and just ask that you would be with Virginia and the family, and just help us to remember the contribution that he made here. We pray with our friend Lauren Craig and his family as he continues to mourn. They continue to mourn their loss, and we lift them to you, praying that you would bless and encourage them at this time. We lift to you my mother-in-law, Margaret Steph, who had to have a pacemaker put in this week. And we're thankful for those that were involved in that process. And we just pray that you would continue to be with her. We do pray for Tony Carlisano and ask that you would be with him, that you give him strength and encouragement as he continues to recover from his accident and heart attack. Father, we lift to you the brother-in-law of Steve and Shelley McClure, Greg, who is battling cancer, and we ask, Lord, that your hand would be upon him, a hand of comfort, a hand of healing, that you give him strength this day. We lift to you our friend Nathan as he has a job interview tomorrow. We pray that everything goes according to your will, that everything goes well in that, Lord. We lift to you all those that are traveling. We think of Jill Vesta this morning and others as well that are traveling to their homes, and ask that you give them safety as they travel. We pray for healing for many people in our congregation and our communities. We think of little Cheyenne as well, who injured herself at school a week or so ago, and just ask that you be with her and give her strength and be with her mom and the family as well. And we do think of the young ladies, the expectant mothers that are connected with our congregation. And Father, we lift every single one of them to you, recognizing the miracle that is the birth of a child. And we pray that your hand of healing and strength would be upon each of these young ladies, Kelsey and Jesse and Laura Beth and Melody. We just lift them all to you, praying that you would work and that you would bless them as they expect the delivery of their precious little bundles. And Lord, again, we give you thanks and praise for all the ways that you work. And we know that each of us have other unspoken requests. We lift those to you this day as well, seeking your leadership in our lives and seeking glory for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, if you'll listen as the choir sings Let It Be Christmas, and this is kind of, it's not a toe-tapping song, but if you start to feel the toe-tapping a little bit, that's okay. And we've challenged the choir to really make sure to smile as we sing the song. And you know what will really encourage them to smile? Is if you smile at them, all right? So if you make eye contact with a choir member and they're not smiling, you give them a big smile, all right?
Red.
As the choir comes down to join you, the children can prepare to be dismissed for children's church. There they go. And again, thinking about the parade this past week, I want to, we were blessed too that we had 3 gingerbread men when we started. Our expectation was 3, and then there was 1 young man that late in the process showed up. And I don't know how, but somebody said to Dylan, "Hey, you want to be a gingerbread man?" And he said, "I can." And I was like, "Well, but do you want to be it?" He kept saying, "Well, I can." And so as you see in those pictures, if you want Dylan to do something, all you got to do is ask, and apparently he'll do it. So, because how many of you, if I just showed up today and said, "By the way, I got these costumes in the other room," and said, "Hey, you want to put one on?" Most of you probably say, "I'll pass, thank you very much." All right, well, this morning we begin today, Sunday, November 28th, 2021. This is the first Sunday of Advent. And Advent is a time of preparation. It's a time of contemplation. Preparation and contemplation of the celebration of Christmas. You know, and we often associate Christmas with giving gifts. We think about enjoying time together with friends and family. We associate it very often with the different foods that we celebrate with. And it's a time when we're really meant to reflect on the truth that God left the glories of heaven and he became a man. And that man's name is Jesus. Amen. Advent is about perspective. You know, and it doesn't take much in our lives to change our perspective. You know, sometimes we think it's going to take a lot, but it can take 1 phone call and our perspective shifts entirely. And so Advent is meant to challenge us. It's meant to cause us to think, to really think about the incarnation, the birth of God the Son. And so this morning, we're beginning a sermon series that will take us through this entire Advent season. We're going to explore a hymn. It's kind of going to be our outline. We're going to hang all of our information on over the next several weeks. And if I'm honest with you, it's a hymn that is not a particular favorite of mine. We sang it this morning, O Come, Emmanuel, and I don't think we're planning to sing it every single week of December. But it's not a particular favorite of mine. It's in a minor key, and it's a little bit slower, and that's okay, but it does speak of rejoicing. But it's a very somber song, and in many ways, it's kind of like a prayer. And this song is connected with what are called the O
antiphones, and I know I just lost a whole bunch of you. The O antiphones. And they are used by other denominations in the celebration of Advent. And what does that mean? Well, an antiphone, or something that is antiphonal, is a something that causes a response, or there's a response. All right? And we sometimes do that. You know, we don't very often do it, but sometimes we have responsive readings, right? Where I'll say something and then the congregation responds. And so that's really what that word is all about. But the song, O Come Emmanuel, includes many of these so-called O antiphones. There's O Come Emmanuel. There's O Come Thou Wisdom, O Come Thou Branch or Root of Jesse, O Come Thou Key of David, O Come Thou Bright and Morning Star. And so you can kind of see that. And it's very interesting if you research this song, and I know all of you are going to go out this afternoon and get on your computer and research that, but there's all kinds of different verses for O Come Emmanuel. The version that we sang this morning had the verses in a different order than I'm used to them, but that's okay. But there's many different verses. And so our purpose is to realize that in these different verses of this song, we see different titles for Jesus Christ, our Messiah, our Lord and Savior. We see different titles for this child who was born on Christmas Day. And so our purpose is to change our perspective. To be like the Hebrews or the Israelites, you know, they looked for the first coming of Jesus. We look back to the first coming of Jesus. But we are still challenged to look forward to what? The second coming of Jesus. This morning, as we look and use this hymn kind of as our guide through this next several weeks, we begin with O Come Emmanuel. Now, in the tradition that uses these responsive reading, this is actually the very last one. They would read this on December 23rd. You know? They would read it on December 23rd, but as we're using this song to kind of be our guide, be our outline, it's the first one that we see. In fact, when we see the name of the song, it's O Come, Emmanuel, after the first couple words. But the antiphone might read something like this. O Emmanuel, King and Lawgiver, Desire of the Nation, Savior of all people, come and set us free, Lord our God. Israel had prophesied, the Lord himself will give you this sign. The virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. And of course, that's based on a portion of the prophecy of Isaiah. In Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, there we read, Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Now, really quickly, for those of you that love biblical languages, and I know that there are some of you out there because you talk to me about it, but for those of you that like biblical languages, when we think of this name, Emmanuel, we really can see it in three parts. There's M, say that with me, M. There's nu, and then there's L, all right? So M, nu, L. And I know you hate to do this, but we're going to start over here. You guys say M, not yet, when I point to you. You guys say nu when I point to you. You guys say L when I point to you. And you guys up there and you guys up there just look pretty and smile, okay? All right, so you ready?
M.
Let's try a little more gusto.
M.
All right, there you go. Some of you even smiled, you crazy people. Anyways, but we hear that, you know, in the name Emmanuel, right? Now, M is a Hebrew preposition that means with. Nu is a special Hebrew suffix that means us as an object, you know, or a direct object. And L is the Hebrew noun that means God. M-nu-el. Literally, if you look at those parts, it means with us, God. Or as we see, especially in Matthew chapter 1, 23, where we read all that and it says, or translated, God with us. So in that name, we see that idea literally spelled out for us. And so if we understand that Emmanuel literally means God with us, the question for us today is then, well, how do we apply that? What should we think? What can we take away from that? Well, this morning, as we contemplate it, as we allow the verse of O Come, Emmanuel to resonate in our hearts and in our minds, as we consider the three parts of this name, M-N-U-L, we should challenge ourselves. Now, first, as we see God and we see us, right? Those ideas are pretty straightforward, aren't they? God and us. God is our creator. God is our savior. God is our Lord. God is our king. He is our master, right? And we realize and we understand that Jesus is God. Jesus is divine. And some will say, well, you know, Jesus never claimed to be God, but that isn't true. He absolutely did. And just as an example, we see in John chapter 8, we read these words. These are the words of Jesus Christ, who said, most assuredly I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. Now, you know, that may seem confusing to you. And you go, well, what's the significance of that? What does that mean? How does that mean anything about being God? Well, Jesus was talking to a group of Jewish people who knew their Bible pretty well. In Exodus chapter 3, verse 14, God said to Moses, I am who I am. And so when Jesus said before Abraham, I am, was I am, he was claiming to be God. And you say, well, how do we know that? Well, we can tell that by the reaction of these Jewish people. Now, if I just stood up here and said to you, I am, you'd say, you are what? You know? And you just go, you just sit there going, okay, well, finish your sentence. These Jewish people, when Jesus said, before Abraham was, I am, they picked up stones and were going to throw them at him. They were going to kill him because of his statement. So they knew that he was claiming to be God. We see also that others recognize that. We think about after his crucifixion, the centurion that witnessed the crucifixion said, truly this man is the Son of God in Mark chapter 15, verse 14. So this morning, we're not here to debate whether Jesus is God. But rather, we remember and we celebrate this truth. And we see it represented in this name, God with us. The second aspect of this name that we're going to look at very quickly draws our attention to that suffix, new. And it means, again, us. God and us. And here we are reminded that, no big shocker, that we are different. Did you know that? We are separate from God. We are not God. Oh, now sometimes we live our lives and like we think we're God. But God is the creator. We are his creation. Right? Amen. God is the one to be worshipped. We are the ones who worship. God is the provider. We are the ones for whom the provision has been given. God is divine. We are human. All too human. God is perfect. Last time I checked, we are not. We are not. But God is divine and we are human. And that's what makes Jesus so unique. Because he is fully God, totally divine in nature, and yet at the same time, he is fully man, totally human in nature. And we go, yep, I got that. Fully God, fully man. And it's one of those things that we really cannot understand, because in his body, you know, if we think, you know, I was telling somebody the other day that my family, two different members of my family had their heritage checked through their DNA, and my aunt her DNA, they were all excited because her DNA had a little bit of like Israeli in it, just a little bit, just a teeny, teeny fraction of a percentage in it. And so we were like, oh, okay, well, that's interesting. But then my uncle had his DNA and it wasn't there at all. And I'm sitting there going, well, they both have the same parents. How can that be? How can they not have the same makeup? You know? I thought, well, I don't know who I am now, I guess, because my genetic, I got two alternatives. You know, but if you think about that, you know, they give you a percentage. You're so much this, so much that, so much that. And when we think about Jesus, Jesus is 100% God. At the same time, he's 100% man. He's not 200%, he's 100% of both. And again, we go, yep, okay, I got that. But it's one of those things that we really can't comprehend because we're not God. But that's what the scripture tells us. So as we look at this, we recognize that God is God. We are human. We are us. And so the key to this idea really lands and is found in this last part of this name. We've got the El, we've got the Nu, and we've got the M. There you go, M. M. And M is with. Now the word with is a simple word, right? We use it all the time. It means to accompany. It means to possess a feature. You know, and we probably said that word thousands and thousands of times, all right? We use it in simple answers to simple questions like, what do you want for lunch? I'll have a cheeseburger or a hamburger with cheese, or a hamburger with french fries, or a hamburger with a salad, right? As long as I can have a hamburger, right? People will say, well, where are you going? Well, I'm going to church with my family. And this word with, as part of this name, Emmanuel, it carries with it special meaning, a special idea, because in it we see the idea of identification and we see the idea of nearness. Emmanuel, Emmanuel, reminds us that our God is not some distant being that resides on some distant planet. No, our God desires to be near to us. He desires to be near to us. You know, if we look back over the history of mankind, and I know it goes for thousands of years, right? But if we go back over the history of mankind, where does it begin? It begins in a garden. The Garden of Eden. And in Genesis chapter 2, we see God fellowshipping with Adam and Eve. God is near to them. God is with them. He was with them. They were together. And God did not make them or did not cause them to leave. No, they made that choice. They made that choice. Because Adam and Eve, they were deceived by Satan and they sinned. And as a result, God could not be in their presence. They could not be in God's presence because God cannot fellowship with sin. But God knew what would happen. And before Adam and Eve were ever created, God had a plan put in place. And it involved Jesus, right? It involved Emmanuel. And he what? He came to earth. He lived a perfect sinless life on this earth. Among whom? Us. Among people. He went to the cross. He suffered and he died for the sins of all mankind. He rose from the dead and he brought us victory over death, hell, and the grave. And he made it possible for us by grace through faith to once again come into the presence of God. So God the Father was there, present with his creation, with us. Jesus was born and was present with us. And when Jesus ascended, he said, you know what? I'm going to send something to you, someone to you. I'm going to send the promised comforter. And God didn't forget. He sent that promised comforter, the Holy Spirit, who had been present and working all along. But now, he comes and he indwells us as believers. So this new, this little suffix, this tiny word part, should cause us to stop and to reflect upon the great truth that when we say God with us, we are saying God near us. We are saying that God wants to be present with us. God wants to be present in us. He doesn't want to be distant. In fact, this promise, this truth, we see it several times in the Bible that God wants to be with us. God doesn't want to be separated with us. If we go back and look in the Old Testament in Joshua chapter 1, verse 5, and then in the New Testament in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5, God says what? He says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And we see that, don't we? God was present with them. Jesus was present with them. The Holy Spirit is present with us. We see this promise in the words of Jesus as well. And it's fascinating because these are some of the last words that Jesus says. They aren't the very last words, but these are some of the last words that Jesus says in Matthew chapter 28. And I know you're going to go, well, I've heard that passage before, but listen to it till I get to all the way to the end. In Matthew 28, verse 19, it says, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And that's where we think about it. Well, there's the Great Commission. I got it. Okay. But it doesn't end there, because what does he say? He says, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. And like she said, he ends it, or the passage is ended with an amen. God with us. Emmanuel, I am with you always. You know, in this name, Emmanuel, we realize that our God, the living God of the universe, he desires to be near to us. He is near us. He is with us. And let's take just another step. Let's make this even more personal. God desires to be near to me. God desires to be near to you. Each of you that is sitting in the pew this morning, each person that will watch this recording of this service, in Jesus Christ, we see God's great desire to be near us. He doesn't want to be separated from us. He doesn't want to be distant to us. He doesn't want to be absent in our lives. No, time and time and time and time and time again, our God has shown that he wants so much to be near to us, to identify with us. The question, the response, the antiphone then is whether we want to be near God. You know, in this hymn, O Come, Emmanuel, we cry out our desire to be in the presence of God. The first verse speaks of captivity, and it speaks of exile, and that's a time away when they were taken away. But more than this, it speaks of Israel's longing for the Son of God to appear. The song says, we are separate from God. It says, but we're looking forward to when the Son of God will come. In Emmanuel, we realize that God has done everything possible in order for us to be near to each other. So, do we want to be near to God? You know, at Christmas, We think of all the great Christmas carols. You know, I mentioned that I don't really particularly like "O Come, O Come, Emmanuel," but I can still learn from it. I like songs like "The First Noel," you know, "Away in a Manger," and so many others. But the truth is that God is with us. He is near us. Maybe this morning the song we should consider is "Nearer My God to Thee." It says, "Nearer my God to thee, nearer to thee, even though it be a cross that raiseth me. Still all my song shall be nearer my God to thee, nearer my God to thee, nearer to thee." Today's the first day of Advent. We have a long month ahead of us, and you know what? It goes by like this, doesn't it? This morning I was noticing this past week, the gentleman that comes and cleans the rugs for the church, I was telling somebody, I feel like it happens every other day, but it doesn't. It's a month between times. But that time between each of those cleanings is getting shorter and shorter. Today's November 28th. We'll blink an eye and we'll be celebrating the arrival of 2022. And we'll look back and say, "Oh, I could have, or I should have, or I wish I would have during the Christmas season." Well, now's the chance to stop and to think and to contemplate the incarnation, the birth of Jesus Christ, when we consider Emmanuel, God with us. Now is the day to make that choice, to spend this Advent season in pursuit of being nearer to God, because you know what? God is with us. So let us take time to draw near to Him. Let us make time to commune with Him. Let us find ways to enjoy God. You know, He's not some relic or some knick-knack that just sits on a shelf and we dust Him off at Christmas and Easter. No, He's a person. And as Emmanuel tells us, He's here with us right now. It's like Him sitting in the pew right next to you and you never talk with Him. You never acknowledge Him. You never greet Him. You never talk to Him. Let us make that choice. Let us purpose to worship Him, to honor Him, to celebrate Him. Because God is with us. Are we with Him? Let's pray. Father God, we thank You so very much for this opportunity that You give us to come together to worship You in spirit and in truth. And we thank You for this song that challenges us to remember these different titles of Jesus, our Savior, whose birth we celebrate this month. We pray, Lord God, that as we see this word Emmanuel, that as we think about it, that as we sing about it, that we would be mindful that in it, it speaks of You, Lord, it speaks of us, and it speaks of Your desire to be near to us, that You are with us. And so we pray, Lord God, today that each of us that are here, we would make a choice and that we would purpose in our lives to spend these next few weeks with the desire of drawing closer to You, of taking the time to read Your word, to pray to You, to listen to You as You speak to our hearts, to remember what it is You have done and to remember why You've done it. Because we needed You to do it, but because You loved us so much that You want to have a relationship with us. We pray that each one of us here today has made the choice to accept Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, realizing that there's no other way for us to be saved except by grace through faith in Jesus and His atoning blood. Father, we lift Him up this day, and pray that You would speak to our hearts, that You would challenge us this day, that You would help us as we go forward to truly celebrate the truth of what Christmas is all about, the birth of our Savior, Jesus Christ. In His name we pray, amen. Will you stand as we have our song of response? Emmanuel, evening at 6 p.m. for our carols and candlelight service. It is always a highlight of the calendar, and so we look forward to seeing you this evening. But let us be dismissed with prayer. Father God, we ask that you go with us now as we go to our homes or other destinations. We do pray that the truth of your word, the truth of this name, that it would resonate in our hearts and minds this day, throughout this week, that it would change the way that we look at Christmas as a reminder that you desire to be present with us. You desire to be near to us. And that's why you sent your Son. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.